Gentlemen, welcome back to the Nexa front lawn for an exciting book launch, The Vault of Vishnu by Ashwin Sanghi. The launch will be by Sonali Bendre Behl and is presented by the Bank of Baroda. Ashwin Sanghi ranks among India's highest selling English fiction authors. He has written the bestsellers The Rozabal Line, Chanakya's Chant, The Krishna Key, The Sialkot Saga, and Keepers of the Kalachakra, as well as two New York Times best-selling thrillers, crime thrillers, with James Patterson. Sonali Bendre Behl is an award-winning Indian film actress, TV personality, and author of The Modern Gurukul, My Experiments with Parenting. In 2017, she started a digital book club called Sonali's Book Club. And I will ask you to join me, please, in welcoming to the stage Ashwin Sanghi and Sonali Bendre Behl. To introduce the launch, I will now invite to the stage Mr. Mahendra S. Mahanot, General Manager of the Bank of Baroda, which has sponsored this launch today. Mr. Mahendra S. Mahanot.
Thank you very much, Vishnu Bhai, for giving us opportunity to Bank of Baroda for launching your great book, The book's name is very well known. It is already on the display. And the vault of Vishnu, it is. At the outset, I want to be thanked to be present over here to the long association with JLF, GJLF, in the third year consecutively with Bank of Baroda. It is now the present to be here as a part of, to represent Bank of Baroda over here. And in personally, I'm grateful to be here in this event. I welcome all the literacy personnel coming over here, all writers, all readers, even all visitors from the Bank of Baroda side. As I know, the GJLF 2020 is maintaining the legacy from 2006. It is a great festive. Worldwide, this is a famous and it is a unique festival. Likewise, Bank of Baroda is also maintaining the legacy in the country. We are contributing a lot in the economy of country. And in the our presence is also in the 22 countries, and we are also India's international bank. We want about something about our literacy, something about our bank, that this bank is maintaining the legacy since 1908 and 112 years old nationalized bank. We, after the nationalization in 1969, we have spread all out, all over the country, and after amalgamating Vijaya Bank and Dena Bank on 1st of April 19, we become second largest India's bank, and having its branches, 9,500 branches in the country, and having 13,400 ATMs throughout the country, and having outlets of 22,000 and more outlets are running in the country. We are serving the people by way of taking the deposit traditionally, by way of advancing in the agriculture side, in the SME side, and in the other retail products. We are financing in a traditional way, as well as now bank becomes a having a digital presence. We are not less than a private sector bank in a digital side also. So we want that you all Barodians will like to serve you. In a, we are having our core values. We are customer-centric bank and having wanted to serve entire nation in a big way. We again want to thankful to the GJLF to giving us opportunity to be associate here. Thank you very much. Thanks to all. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's amazing and lovely to be here. And look at the crowd. That's rocking. Thank you so much, all of you. And Ashwin, congratulations.
Thank you, Sonali. This book is going to rock, by the way, guys. And the reason it's going to rock is because Sonali is my lucky charm. Ah. Whenever she has been in conversation with me on any book, it has always rocked. So
I thought all your books rocked, and I would love to believe that I was part of all of them, but it's him, not me. It's given me goosebumps when I saw this video, and it's looking so exciting. I'm dying to read it. I'm so glad. You've taken so long to launch it.
I know.
You've been promising us this book for so long, and what took you so long?
It has taken a long time, and the reason is because it's a very different sort of story. Whenever you ask me to write something which is intrinsically Indian, I don't have a problem in terms of writing it, because all the inspiration, all the material, all the grassroots knowledge to a certain extent is already there. But this story is set half in China and half in India. And I genuinely was fascinated by the fact that there was so much sharing that happened between these two great civilizations, but we have not brought it into the realm of popular fiction. So for example, we all know that Buddhism went from India to China. But what made that Buddhism actually happen? What made it travel? Similarly, there are other facets that we are not aware of.
For example, all these trips that you've been taking to China have been for research?
Absolutely. So it's to a very great extent. I mean, I'm one of those, I want to find out little details about a place that then I can include into my story, and then I can make you go, aha, wow, how did he think of that? And that only happens actually through being there.
So how many trips to China?
So, one of them was a very long trip, one more which was a shorter one. So between those two, it was roughly about 4 or 5 weeks.
Okay.
But the reason it could be done within that short period of time was because I already had a very, very well formulated itinerary in terms of where I need to go.
Okay.
And specifically, even within cities or villages or towns, I knew specifically what I wanted to see.
So obviously, we are all dying to know what the secret is, and that's why we're going to read the book. But tying in China, India, you've got Cambodia in it. You've kind of covered the whole subcontinent in that sense.
But, you know, this is what it is. People asked me when I wrote this book, they said that, you know, you call this the Bharat series, but half of this story is in China. So what's going on? And I said, no, Bharat is not just the geographical location. It's also about the ideas and how those ideas moved.
So, you know, that's the question I want to ask you, because this is your sixth book in Bharat series.
That's right.
It's not like it's a trilogy and, you know, similar characters moving forward, or normally when you have certain tie-ups that happen and something flow. They're very distinct and different stories. The eras are
sure.
Different, times are different.
Sure.
Yet it's Bharat series.
Yes.
What is the link? Why do you call them your Bharat series?
Because the roots of that story lie in Bharat. So, for example, if you read, let's say, my first book, The Rozabal Line, a lot of that story takes place in many places outside of India. But that story comes back and connects to something that is intrinsically within Bharat. Right. It could be the location of that story, it could be the idea of the story, it could be the inspiration of the story, but it is intrinsically Bharat.
So how many more books in Bharat series?
I hope that I will turn out a Bharat series book every 2 years till the time that I die.
Just for your information, his birthday is coming up, 25th, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
I have an affinity to Aquarians.
You have an affinity because your husband is just on the 24th of Jan.
Yeah, but so what's the birthday gift to yourself? Is there a new idea? What's happening? Because, see, we are going to read this book. It's been launched. I already want to pick on your brain, that what is happening in there? What is the next idea?
For me right now, you know, in that sense, those who know me and those who have been reading my books are fully aware of the fact that it takes me 2 years to turn out a book in the Bharat series. But why is that 2 years? Because typically 8 or 9 months goes away in ideation and research. There is the old proverb which says that if you're going to tell a lie, then tell the lie close to the truth. So I try and tell that lie close to the truth. I'm a fiction writer and I try and spin an interesting story, but I know that it's going to take me that much time.
So, you know, you have it quite figured out, 2 years,
yeah.
And you have a pattern to it. How lonely is it when you start writing?
Not at all, because I mean, I'm not one of those writers who holds myself up into a cubbyhole and writes. Very often I'll be sitting in my living room, on the couch. If it's morning, I might have a cup of coffee next to me. If it's the evening,
so
my single malt
Anu,
may have
your
been,
wife doesn't get a break from you.
She never gets a break from me. You know, I mean, but frankly, Sonali, she has no one else to blame but herself. Because had it not been for Anu, that first book would never have been written. So, unfortunately, she created a monster out of me.
Fortunately, but can you tell us more about that?
So, when I was writing The Rozabal Line, in fact, I hadn't started writing it. I had just done the research. I had gone on a chance trip to Srinagar. I had looked at that particular tomb in the heart of Srinagar, which the popular folklore is that the person buried there is Jesus Christ. And I was fascinated by that story. And I ended up spending the next year and a half researching the story. At the end of that period, I had lots and lots of information, going round and round in my head. And I thought to myself, I said, there are so many linkages between these multiple threads that can I look at creating a thesis? So I wrote a thesis to connect the dots of various parts of the research that I had done. And then I gave that piece of paper to dear Anu. And I said, Anu, isko zara padho aur batao ki whether this is making sense. And she read it, and the next morning she said, congratulations, Ashwin, I think you've discovered the cure for insomnia. Because, you know, this was like, I read two pages and I was completely out. You know, it's so boring. Isko kaun padhega? So that's the time I realized that it needed to be made into a story. It needed to be written as a story. And that's how the Rozabal line ended up getting written.
So did she read the story first before you sent it out to anybody?
Yes, she did.
Did she fall asleep then?
No, actually what happened was the Rozabal line was frankly written as a book by a person who knew nothing about writing. I hadn't written anything longer than a couple of pages before the Rozabal line. And here I was trying to write 100,000 words. And I tied myself up into knots writing that story because there was no planning, there was no systematic approach. If you read the Rozabal line, it travels in time between 3,000 odd years and within the flip of a page. As a result of which, for those who were trying to read that book, very often they got completely and utterly confused.
Right.
Luckily for me, there were those who actually appreciated that. They liked the mess that I had created. And they said, oh, wow, this is beautiful writing. And it took on a life of its own. But that wasn't of my making because it was written as a bad book.
You know, I really would like to know more about how you write your books and what is the thought process that happens. But I'm going to save that for my book club.
Sure.
You have to promise me that you're going to do a masterclass for us.
Absolutely. And by the way, for those of you who
guys,
are not aware,
you will have to go on my book club and hear the secrets. I'm not going to let him share that here. For that, you have to be on the book club.
You know, we all look at Sonali, and she is such an inspiration for all of us. The way that she has dealt with her life
and
the challenges in those lives.
This is about you and your book today.
But I want to say to the audience that that book club of yours is a labor of love. And I really hope that a lot of people will log on to that Facebook page of Sonali's book club. And they will realize what is the sort of material that she is absorbing in order that she can bring it to you with those authors.
It gives me joy. But right now, this is about you. And I have a question for you.
Sure.
Bharat series, you have a lot of them in your mind, in your head, a lot of ideas floating. Are you thinking of any more collaborations?
I did two collaborations in the fiction space. Yes.
I have a confession
yes.
to make. I don't know if anybody else agrees with me, but I like the undiluted pure Ashwin Sanghi more than the collabs. So are you planning any more collabs? I have put it out there.
Realistically speaking, I don't think so. Because what I'm finding is that, it's not only about eventually having a finished product in terms of a book, it's also the journey that you take in getting there. I had a rollicking time writing those two crime thrillers with James Patterson. There was no question about it. It was a wonderful time. But the journey that I take every time that a Bharat series book is about to come out, and the way I just lose myself in that research, and then of course the plotting and the writing of the book, that is a completely different experience. And I'm realizing that I cannot replicate that when I'm actually trying to work in tandem with someone else. So I think what you're going to see is far more attention of Ashwin Sanghi on the Bharat series, because I think that is what people love about Ashwin Sanghi's writing. The Bharat
Absolutely.
Series is what
I agree.
Is the mainstay.
Who else agrees to that? Just look at that. So you
Thank
think
you.
We have a wonderful audience here. You think
sure.
we should give them an opportunity to talk to you,
but
ask some questions.
But Sonali, before that, I want to say a few things about this entire writing journey, as it were.
I thought you were saving it for my book club.
I will reveal more details about that in the book club. But for me, for anyone who knows me, they will, or follow me on Facebook, they know that at the end of the day, I'm not just one of those people who tries to promote a certain religious point of view, because I genuinely feel that to a very great extent, religion and philosophy are very, very separated items.
So are you religious?
So this is the point that, to my mind, I think philosophy is questions that you will never answer. Religion is answers that you will never question. And the two are extremely different. To my mind, what I hope for through the writings that I present is that you would actually question, that you would think, oh, is this possible? I know for a fact that when we are looking at this huge audience, there will be people who are extremely religious, and there are people who are not at all religious. But remember one thing, that there is a meeting ground for all of those people. I can't remember who it was who said that, you know, there is a touch of doubt in every believer, and there is a touch of belief in every non-believer. And these books are meant to sort of arouse that belief or doubt, as you may hold it. I mean, when I wrote the Krishna Key, I was trying to answer a rather important question, and that question came back to the fore recently, because I have this tradition: whenever a Bharat series book is about to come out, after I'm done signing the first 1,000 books in the series for my friends, family, well-wishers, I put aside the first book, the very first book of that 1,000. And the next morning, I leave my house in the morning at about 5:30, and I walk from my house to Siddhi Vinayak Mandir in Mumbai, which is about roughly 2.5 hours away. And once I reach there at about 7:30 in the morning, I take my first book, that first copy, and I put it in front of Ganesh Ji, and I say, you are the ultimate scribe, so please read my book. And I come away feeling content. Now, it doesn't mean that I literally believe that there is a deity called Ganesh, but I believe that there is a greater power. And we've not understood what that greater power is. If I look at a book like the Krishna Key, in that there is an equation in that book, surprisingly enough, which is called G is equal to infinity minus K. And people ask me about that. And I say, well, G is God, and infinity is the whole universe, and K is the extent of human knowledge. So what you don't know is what you attribute to God. The Egyptians saw the sun rise in the east, set in the west, and they thought, oh, this is the sun god. He gets up in the morning and travels across the skies in his chariot, and at night he gets tired and he goes to sleep, and that's when we have night. And later on, of course, Galileo and Copernicus and many others eventually told us that, hey, listen, that, you know, it's a ball of fire, and we revolve around that ball of fire. And suddenly poor Ra, the Egyptian god Ra, was no longer divine, because now we knew what it was. But you know what? When I went this time with this book to Siddhi Vinayak, and I was standing there in front of Ganesh Ji, and of course, by the way, my meetings with Ganesh Ji tend to be a little awkward, because I sometimes feel that I'm meeting my own twin, because, you know, of our physique. So I say, hey, Ganesh, you know, and he also says, hey, Ashwin, to me. And we have this little conversation in our heads. And then, you know, I thought to myself, I said, if you have any equation which has infinity on one side of that equation, then when you add or subtract anything to infinity, the result will be undefined because of the infinity factor. And that's really what God is, infinite and yet undefined.
So I want to know, what are all those threads on your wrist? Because while you talk about religion and God and everything, I want to see, they're very colorful, they're beautiful.
So,
and I saw that post of yours also. That's what drew my attention.
Actually, the post that Sonali saw was basically me holding up my socks as well as my arm.
Yeah.
Because they look very similar in terms of those loops, the bands.
So what is the story behind these?
So these bands actually are, of course, from various mandirs, dargahs, gurdwaras, and what have you. Because ultimately, we are talking about one power. We are talking about one greater power. But in everyone's life, there is always something which drives you to be inspired. I have always believed in the force of Shakti. Shakti, for me, plays a critical role. When I'm sitting down to write, I'm not thinking about Shivji, I'm thinking of Shakti. And how do I visualize them? I visualize them not as opposite forces. They are not opposite forces. People think that they are opposite forces. Think about this, that if you have an absence of light, then you get darkness, right? They are not opposites. It's the absence of one. The absence of heat leads to cold. It's not opposites. It's the absence of a particular element. The same applies with Shiv and Shakti, that the absence of Shakti is Shiv. As simple as that. And so when I think about my own life, and of course for me, the number five also has a very great importance. The number five, actually in some ways, if you think about it, the ancient pyramids.
So you're into numerology also?
Not really. There is an element of that. Think about it. Why did Krishna ask for five villages in the Mahabharata? Why are there five elements in Panchamrit? Why were there five stars on the flag of Bhishma Pitamai? Why were there five Pandava brothers? Five plays a very important role. It's a recurring theme through our myths. And in fact, not just us, even the ancient Egyptians, they erected pyramids which had five faces. Because if you take the four sides and the base, it's five sides. So for me, there are five elements of Shakti in my life. And the first Shakti in my life is my mother.
Okay.
Because had it not been for her, I would never have got into the reading habit.
Right.
The second Shakti in my life is my sister, Vidhi, who lives in Delhi. And she has been one of those who always told me, do whatever you feel like doing. Don't get bound down by chains that because you happen to be this, therefore you need to be this. Then there are two more Shaktis, and both of them are here with me today. One of them is my wife, Anu, and one of them is my Rakhi sister, Farah. Where are they? Can we focus on them? Can we focus on them?
They're feeling shy.
Anu, and where is Farah?
There, right next to
me. Right there. So, both of them are right there. So those are the third and fourth Shaktis in my life. And of course, the fifth and the ultimate Shakti is Ma Shakti herself. And it is only as a result of, and that's why you see that there are five Dhagas. It's not six, it's not four, there are five Dhagas. So ultimately, jo bhi kuch bhi karta hai apni life mein, it is because of Shakti. And recognition of that Shakti is so important. There are times, Sonali, when I read something that I have written and I wonder to myself that how did I write this? Did I write this?
And then?
And then when I look back at it, I say, no, at that moment when I was writing it, I was just conveying something and this is not my writing. I am incapable of writing something like this. I am incapable of thinking like this.
You know, you also come from a family which is not of writers. Mm-hmm. It's a business family. And mm-hmm. it was something very different that you did when you started writing and you became an author. And you've actually given up the family business and you've gone
Absolutely.
Into this. It was quite the leap of faith.
It was a total leap of faith because honestly speaking, the culture that I come from, I mean, you know, if you had to read something, then you read a balance sheet. You didn't read books. And I mean, in most of our Banya families, the two most important words, you know, hum log Ram Naam ka jap nahi karte hain in front of the child. Or we don't say Hari Om, we say debit credit, you know. And those are the words that we make sure that that little boy it grows up with. You know, when I was researching for this book, there is a little passage which talks about the merchants of Tashkent. Huh. the merchants of Tashkent, the merchants of Samarkand. And they had a very interesting tradition that whenever a child was born, they would touch a drop of honey to the child's tongue. And they would touch a little bit of glue to the child's palm. And what was the logic of that? That let this boy grow up to be a merchant who has the sweetest tongue to be able to sell anything, and let him have a touch of glue on his palm so that when he holds money, it just sticks to him.
Good one.
And that was the environment that I grew up in.
So what was the debit and credit in your Bharat series now?
So frankly, I think if you ask me what changed in my life was one individual, and his name was Ram Gopal Gupta. He lived in Kanpur. He was my maternal granduncle, not even my direct grandfather, my grandfather's brother. Okay. And he would always, when I would go to him and I would say that, you know, they are saying that I should be a businessman, that I should learn debit credit, I should know bookkeeping, and I should be able to read a balance sheet. And he would say that, remember one thing, beta, in life, you need both Lakshmi and Saraswati. And it's a very important thing to have both in your life. So he would say the equation between Lakshmi Saraswati is something which is not explainable. He would say that Saraswati, wherever she is, Lakshmi wants to go there. So if Saraswati happens to be here, then Lakshmi also wants to follow and be here. And if Saraswati gets up and leaves, then Lakshmi is wondering, where has she gone? And so she also gets up to leave. So he said that, remember one thing, even if you want to follow money, even if you want Lakshmi, follow Saraswati, because Lakshmi will come.
That was a good one.
And I was thinking about this, and then, you know, Nanaji then tried to make it work, and so during the next about 15 or 20 years, he would send me one book every week from Kanpur to read. Over his lifetime, he sent me somewhere between 350 and 400 books. And that was where my love for reading came from. But you know one thing, when Lakshmi and Saraswati, they sit together, there is only one deity in the Hindu pantheon that can actually sit between them, and that is Ganesh, which probably explains why I look the way I do, because it's been a lifelong quest to somehow or the other keep Lakshmi and Saraswati on either side. And well, I mean, you know, I would say this to all the youngsters here who plan to be aspiring writers one day. You will have lots and lots of obstacles along the way. I got rejected 47 times by publishers and literary agents before the book got published, the first book got published. And to my mind, if you can think of this journey as a quest for Saraswati and look at Lakshmi as a byproduct that comes along the way, your journey will be that much easier.
That holds true for all of us, actually. Be it in any field, and well said, very, very well said.
Thank you.
So you're very confident about this book, like you said at the beginning.
To my mind, I think for anyone who has read 3, 4, 5 books in the Bharat series, I think they are going to find this very, very exciting. How many of you are familiar, show of hands please, how many of you are familiar with the name Bodhidharma? Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Jaipur. At least another 30 or 40 hands have gone up. Bodhidharma, you know, we know very little about someone called Bodhidharma. Right. But when I was researching this book, I realized that Bodhidharma was none other than a Pallava prince. A Pallava prince who had learnt South Indian martial arts. And here, this prince decides that he will travel to China. And when he is in China, he goes and he stands before the chief monk at the Shaolin monastery. And he says, "Admit me." And the abbot of the monastery says, you are not ready. So Bodhidharma retires from there to a cave very close to the temple. And he sits there in meditation for 9 years. He sits there in meditation to the point where the light that is trickling into the cave reflects off him and imprints his shadow on the opposite wall because he has not moved. And in those 9 years, he does not emerge from that cave, but he needs to keep his limbs moving. He needs to keep his blood circulation going. So he falls back on 3 very important learnings from India: Kalaripayattu, Silambam, and yoga. And he devises a routine which can keep him in action. At the end of the 9 years, the abbot of Shaolin gives up. And he says, listen, I have not seen someone more obstinate than you. So I am now admitting you. And Bodhidharma then goes on to teach all of these various mechanisms to the monks of Shaolin. And that becomes something which we now know as Kung Fu. So, and if you go to Shaolin, he is revered. And the entire story of Bodhidharma is within the texts. But within India, we have forgotten it. We have so much ancient, rich culture, tradition, heritage, literature, all available for the asking. All that I'm trying to do in my own small ways is bring some of this into popular discourse, Sonali. That's all.
Wonderful.
That's all.
I think we should open it out.
Okay. Sure.
Because there's so many people,
absolutely,
they're so excited to be here, and I think they all have a lot of questions here.
Absolutely. Yeah? I look forward to it.
Yeah. So we have 5 minutes, and I think we should get in.
Actually, I think, is this timer right? Okay. It's showing. Okay. We'll start.
So this is not right. So let's quickly get on with this. There.
Namaste, sir.
Namaste ji.
So what is the
zara agar aap apna naam bata denge to sabko malum rahega.
Sir Atul Sharma.
Atul ji, bataiye.
What is the difference between mythological and historical events?
Okay,
by
sure.
Point of view.
Sure. In India, somehow or the other, if you really think about it, we had 2 types of writing. We had itihas and we had Puran. Itihas was so-called, jise kehte hain, as it happened. And people think that itihas means history, but it was also talking about events which are yet to happen. On the other hand, you had Puran, which were fantastical tales. We like to think that history is a statement of fact. My view is that it is not. It is a version of events. It was the novelist George Santena who said that history is a pack of lies about events that never happened, written by people who were never there. So in that sense, how much can you rely on what you call itihas? And on the other hand, mythology, if you really think about it, is actually being at the core, is being more honest. Because mythology doesn't attempt to tell you that this is how it happened. What mythology wants to tell you is that there is a deeper truth. Seek that deeper truth in what I am telling you, even in a fantastical tale. So to my mind, mythology is that way far more truthful than history. What I do in my books, frankly, is I look for an overlap between mythology and history. That is there a possibility that something could have been more historical than simply myth? Could the Mahabharata war have happened? Could Krishna, and this happened to me when I went to Calcutta and I had 2-3 hours and I went to a mandir. And when I went into the mandir, I realized that the deity that was being worshipped was Amitabh Bachchan. I went outside of the mandir and I picked up a little book, a prayer book, which was known as the Amitabh Chalisa. And I thought to myself, I said, if in my lifetime an Amitabh Bachchan can be worshipped as a god, then isn't it possible that if I die today and I take rebirth 1,000 years from today, isn't it possible that he may be worshipped now, not in one mandir, but in 1,000 mandirs or 1 lakh mandirs? Isn't that precisely what is happening with people like Krishna, Ram, Jesus, Muhammad, and so many of our prophets, that we now suddenly, those people who were great in history, have now begun to be worshipped down the ages? My view is that there is an overlap between myth and history. So what does Ashwin Sanghi do? He takes these two concepts, myth and history, and he puts them into a particle collider. You've heard of a particle collider, right, at CERN? He puts them into a particle collider and brings them charging towards one another at very high speed. Myth plus history. And by the end of it, you have neither myth nor history. They've combined into a new word, which is called mystery. Myth plus history is mystery. And that's why, you read my books.
Well said.
Hello from Lucknow. I'm Piyush.
And hello, Piyushji.
I admire your research work.
Thank you.
And my question is, you started with a quest from Krishna's Key.
Yes.
And Keepers of Kalachakra, you have elaborately worked on that the theory of everything. If in case you are able to find the theory of everything, how will you execute it in this world?
Oh my God, what a question.
What difference is going to make?
To my mind, honestly speaking, I think that answer lies in that equation which I had spoken about G is equal to infinity minus K. That the moment there is infinity on one side of the equation, there will always be that perpetual quest of man to find out more. But the truth of the matter is that let's assume that for a minute that God is infinity minus knowledge. Let's assume for a minute that knowledge also lands up at infinity. So now we have God is equal to infinity minus infinity. But mathematicians tell us that infinity minus infinity is not zero, which means that there will still be place for God. The point is that even the day that we have that theory of everything, we will still have God. There will still be something which is unexplained, something which is infinite, something which is undefined. And mera to ye kehna hai ki kai log aise hain jo shivling ke samne jaate hain aur wo kehte hain ki ye patthar hai. Aur kai log patthar ke samne jaake kehte hain ye shivling hai. Who is right? I don't know. I hope that we will have this continuous debate going on into the future, because it makes life so much more exciting and interesting.
I think we can take one question more. Just one. Guys,
actually, the culprit is me. I'm giving elaborate replies.
My name is Rachna Saxena, and today has truly been a day of inspiration. I would like to welcome Sonali Bendre for the amazing experience that she has given us to the rest of the of people of India. A lot of thanks to the world of Vishnu, Mr. Ashwin Sanghi. Like to know what is the primary inspiration behind the vault of Vishnu. Thank you.
The vault of Vishnu is inspired by the fact that to a very great extent, man's quest to create perfection. And to my mind, that quest is in some ways misplaced. Because in your way, in my way, we are actually perfect. Our imperfections make us perfect. And so there has always been this entire thing that, oh, can I live forever? Is there that elixir of mortality, immortality, which can... Hamare Hindu mythology mein wo amrit, jisse hum, pata nahi, sadiyon ji sakein. And it has been there in Chinese philosophy also, that elixir of immortality. And of course, we all want to look young. We all want to look virile. We all want to look, you know, as we looked at the time of our respective marriages. I look back at my photographs and I get depressed. But the point is that quest has to be a deeper quest. Your perfection is not going to be in the physical realm. It's going to be way beyond the physical realm. And that is what somewhere we lose sight of. So the vault of Vishnu is a discussion on that quest. Nothing more. Nothing more.
Wow.
Thank you.
So well said. I mean, it took me this last 2 years' journey to reach the same conclusion that nothing is perfect and the beauty is in imperfections. Thank you so much, guys. This was a wonderful journey. Ashwin, all the best. Congratulations and all the very best.
Listen, guys, please give and a special round of applause for Sonali. Because,
thank you.
You know, she is such a sweetheart. The moment I said, listen, I want you to be in conversation with me, she was here. So
well,
thank you.
The joy and the pleasure is mine. It's an amazing mind to be able to pick on, and I love doing that. It's wonderful that you gave me this opportunity, and it was lovely to launch this book. And we are looking forward to many more from you.
Absolutely.
And congratulations again,
thank
and
you.
All the best for this.
Thank
Ashwin.
You, Sonali.
It's a
thank
pleasure.
You. Pleasure always.
Our congratulations to Ashwin Sanghi for the Vault of Vishnu. And thanks also to Sonali Bendre Behl for moderating the launch. Thanks also to Bank of Baroda for presenting the launch today. Just so that you know, Sonali Bendre Behl will be appearing here at the Nexa Front Lawn later today at 3:45 in a session on her book club. So Ashwin Sanghi is now making his way to the Z kiosk, which you'll find at the far right corner of the Nexa Front Lawn. The books are available at the JCB Prize for Literature Bookshop, managed by Full Circle. Please go and buy a copy of his exciting new book and take it to the Z kiosk. He'll be waiting there to sign your book for you and has also very generously said that he'll be happy to continue facilitating questions if you didn't have time to ask your question during the session. In just a few minutes, we'll be going into the next session here at the Nexa Front Lawn. That session is called Present Tense, and the guest speakers are Navdeep Suri, Fintan O'Toole, Omar Gobash, Marcus Moench, and they're appearing in conversation with Rajni Vaidyanathan. Thank you.